Hey there, I'm Bas Amos, business lead from Ambitech.
And I'm Juri Verhalsonk, tech lead from Ambitech.
We started this company in mid-2020. And before that, I used to be a consultant at McKinsey & Company, where I used to visit many office buildings. And especially, I spent a lot of times in the meeting rooms of these companies, where I generally noticed one common theme. People losing concentration, getting tired, getting headaches in each of these meeting rooms. And at that time, I thought that might be because the meeting is boring, or because people are just zoning out, or because maybe the oxygen ran out. And that's when I spoke with Juri.
Yes, so I did a PhD in physical chemistry at the ETH in Zurich. And afterwards, I worked at Sensirion, which is a major player in environmental sensing. So they make temperature sensors, humidity sensors, CO2 sensors, and so forth. And during this time, I experienced the exact problem that Bas was describing, where in meeting rooms, the air quality is really bad. And even at Sensirion, I experienced it when we were making pitch slides for a customer to explain the negative effects of having too much CO2 in a room where our own sensors were blazing red, indicating the CO2 was way too high, off the chart, very, very high. And this inspired me to move one step beyond sensing itself and see if we could really solve the problem and start Ambitech.
The awareness of the importance of indoor air quality has risen substantially since the beginning of the COVID crisis. We spend about 90% of our time indoors, and indoor air quality has a significant impact on us. It impacts us in the following three ways. It reduces, a poor indoor air quality reduces significantly our productivity because it has an impact on our cognitive abilities, as been researched in many different studies. Besides that, it reduces our well-being. Just as I experienced in that meeting room, it creates sleepiness, drowsiness, etc. And last but not least, it has an impact on the spread of infectious diseases. Of course, this is the case for COVID-19, but also so for other infectious diseases that will last long beyond the crisis, such as the cold and the flu. So how did this problem arise? Over the last decades, buildings have become better and better insulated, which on the one hand is a very good thing, because it means that we're reducing our energy consumption on heating our buildings. On the other hand, though, it means that there is less fresh air for the occupants in our buildings. Over the last years, the healthy building movement has taken much more steam and is slowly but steadily improving this. However, it is rather slow because there's mainly three sets of hurdles. Any type of initial installations in buildings are very large investments. Think of the order of hundreds of thousands of euros, even for medium-sized buildings. Subsequently, improving them still requires massive investment because of the incredibly large machinery involved and the large amount of installation efforts. And even simple improvements like we're nowadays seeing in many IoT companies, to simply make the systems more smart and fed by smart meters are generally, if installed by the more traditional installation companies, cabled and therefore still require large amounts of installation and materials.
So because of the costs that Bas just described, many buildings today suffer from poor air quality. And a prime example are schools, especially those in older buildings. Now, faced with starting the new school year during the corona crisis, many schools decided to monitor their air quality. And what most of them did is they got certain so-called traffic lights. And these traffic lights are sensors that show with a green, orange, or red light whether there's too much CO2 in the classroom. And the action would be that then a teacher would, for instance, open a window and make sure there's fresh air coming and thereby reducing the risk of a corona infection. Now, this approach is functional in the short run to mitigate the risks in a very pragmatic way. But in the long run, this is not a sustainable solution. You cannot make a teacher responsible for the air quality in a room. The teacher has to be responsible for teaching. On top of that, you get no structural insight. It's very hard to get a picture of the whole building. Where do I have problems? When do I have problems? How big are my problems? It's very hard to chart and map this and then make data-driven decisions on how to solve your problems with your air quality. Therefore, the best solution would be to monitor the data, but also store it in a central location, allowing analysis of your data and therefore making data-driven decisions to improve the situation. Now, this all becomes much easier with IoT. There are many sensors available that measure CO2, temperature, humidity, particulate matter, and other environmental parameters of interest. Now, this data is easily sent to the cloud, where it can be analyzed and made insightful in such a way for the customer that they immediately see where the problems are and where they should take what action. We create a cloud dashboard that shows at a glance which rooms have good air quality and where improvements are needed. So for instance, here we can see that office one currently has a high CO2 concentration. Also on the right, we can sort them by their average concentrations. Again, we see office one is problematic. By clicking, we can zoom in and see all the measured data and really see when what problem occurred. And this can really help to zoom in where the problem is.
In regular reports, we share practical suggestions with schools on how they can actually optimize the situation. Over here, we will show you three examples of analysis that we shared with them. So in this first analysis, you can see on the horizontal axis the time and on the vertical axis the dates that we're passing. And you can see here the CO2 concentrations for those periods in a specific classroom. And what you can see is that there is clear patterns that we are seeing here. And that in certain times of the day, CO2 concentrations every week again are too high. And this is an indication of two large classes being present in that classroom. And so the optimization that can take place here is that these larger classes are being moved to better ventilated rooms, while smaller classes can take place in this specific room. A second analysis shows more or less the same numbers, but then averaged over a set of classrooms. And what you can see here is that CO2 concentrations in the morning are significantly higher than those in the afternoon. And this is an indication that many more classes are taking place in the morning than in the afternoon. And therefore, you could say that to decrease the overall CO2 levels in the school, it might be wise to move some of the classes that are currently taking place in the morning to the afternoon. In a third analysis, we saw in a specific school something strange happening at night. Basically, what you see in each of these graphs, so we're measuring here in 10 different rooms in the orange lines, and the average is all the time taking in the red line, you see that the temperature is rising every night while it dramatically drops in the morning, meaning that they're heating at night and turning on their ventilation just before the students arrive, meaning that they're wasting a lot of energy. This is something that would never have been noticed if they would not have monitored the situation.
So a very cool thing about an IoT platform is that we're not limited to only sensing the air quality. What we can do is we can take this information and send it back to an actuator and try to improve the situation. So in our office, we have a ventilator in the ceiling that will start to flush the air when CO2 concentrations are too high. So we can also do this on the level of a company where we control their ventilation system, make it go faster or slower depending on the CO2 concentration, and thereby make it demand controlled. This is all fairly straightforward to do with an IoT application and LoRaWAN communication. Now, finally, about this LoRaWAN communication, why do we use LoRaWAN and not Bluetooth Low Energy or Wi-Fi? Well, the main reason is we like our sensors to be battery operated. This gives massive flexibility when it comes to installation. And LoRaWAN is a very convenient protocol for battery operated devices. On top of that, we can be completely autonomous. And by that, I mean that we can use a LoRaWAN gateway, use a 4G backhaul, and we do not need to rely on the customer's IT to get our signal out. Now, this is very advantageous because often due to security issues or changing IT infrastructure, it's not really the most reliable solution to use the IT infrastructure of a school or a company. So all in all, what we have done is we made a very affordable solution using IoT and LoRaWAN to allow companies and schools to regain control of their air quality and thereby ensuring the well-being of their occupants and students. Because we believe that everybody has a right to something as simple as fresh and good air. And we're happy to do this, and please reach out if you have any questions or like to contact us. Thank you for your time.